Marvellous remnants of the of this walled city everywhere. I mean, this is absolutely unbelievable, this place. Right in the middle, next to the new, is the very, very old. Hello.
They make me laugh. They say,
hello. What is your name?
James, come out the way. They don't want you.
That is lovely. We're walking down by the river because we're going to take a boat ride. Parks are not just for children, are they?
All right, there. Regional a bit, I guess.
Sights and sounds everywhere. This is the boat we're going on. We'll get on here and go all around York.
Bishop Walter de Grey. The same Walter de Grey who was responsible for building Bishop Thorpe Palace. And that's the official residence of His Grace, the Archbishop of York. Now, unfortunately for Walter, though, he didn't see the finished minster. It took four generations of stonemasons and craftsmen just over 250 years to build. It stands today, prohibiting the building of anything in the city of York any higher than the minster. The York Minster houses one of the finest collections of 12th century up to present day. Now, the largest and greatest example of this is in the Lady Chapel, and it's called the Great East Window. It's the largest surviving piece of stained glass anywhere in the world. It's 77 feet high and 36 feet wide. Actually covers an area larger than the centre court on Wimbledon. This particular piece of stained glass was the work of John Thornton of Coventry, and it took him 3 years to complete, and he was paid the vast sum of £53 for his 3 years' work. On the central tower of the Minster, one particular bridge joins York with the East Coast wine resorts of Bridlington, Filey, and of course Scarborough.
Are you having a good time?
Before we get to this bridge, if you look to your left-hand side, you'll see all these houses here have a rather unsightly red brick wall and a black steel gate A. But to get around this problem, houses on the east bank would receive water one day, houses on the west the next. This is all except on Sundays, where they might live while flying straight across the river before the bridge was built. Now, on the foot of the bridge, he was made redundant, although he was quite generously given a pension of £25 a year with a horse and cart for the loss of his livelihood. Now, Lenville Bridge itself was built in 1863, and it was made out of cast iron. The bridge itself was designed by Sir Thomas Page, the very same architect, and now placed onto the bridge by the architect as a mark of respect for Victoria and Albert.
This is Traitor's Gate, where prisoners were taken by boat, kept there until they were put on a boat to Australia.
Peaceful on it, isn't it?
penthouses up here cost £500,000.
All over the world, like they are.
These two picnickers certainly found the right place
for picnic. Thank you very much.
Thank you. This is a shopping square. Right in the middle of the modern shopping area, and who would ever think it? We're back in the park because we decided we'd buy a sandwich and come and eat it here. Where else better, really? This is a beautiful peacock. I just wish he'd open up his tail. But I don't think he's going to.
Because we're taken out during
this is a walled city.
We're on the Yorkshire Dales Tame People.
And we're on the outer perimeter of
the wall. It took 20 years to fully restore the windows back in the Minster.
The Minster is over there.
Just ahead.
It was the gate where they would put the heads of the people that would be headed. This is a better picture here of the York Minster.
Now let's go inside one of the houses. Two light centers on the hearth. Chatting, cooking, eating, sleeping, and playing all go on in the one room. Suppose you get around here. Rubbish and dumped in pits. The remains are just cesspits, holes in the ground. This old chap's finding a new one. It's a little bit of a fuss. A cargo ship, So cute, like a boy, listened to all the tales of the travels and adventures of his father, Ottoman, and his grandfather, Captain. Twentieth century York. Between 1976 and 1981, a team from the York Archaeological Trust uncovered the actual remains of the wooden Viking buildings that we've just seen.
We've now traveled back together through the centuries from the
This was York in 948
AD. And behind are the workshops.
Old Fashioned Street in York. Lovely. This is the entrance to the wall that we're going to walk around, which goes all around the city.
No, they shut the gates at dusk.
Looking through one of the safety holes.
Sunglasses all the time, right?
Oh yes, it's very long.
God, the whole road is...
These are some of the houses from around the wall, looking down. That's been, I think, rather nice to live here. Don't you think so? I mean, near the wall. That's very pretty. This is the most incredible shot for the Minster here. Absolutely beautiful. Ooh. We've turned a corner. I have never seen, what is it, the second largest minster?
Yeah.
In England?
Or the largest?
I don't know.
She did say.
Did she?
Yeah.
The largest, you read something else.
Yeah.
They're all the children.
Yeah, they're all the down and out
dogs. Dogs. They all have dogs, apparently.
They're all drinking. All the time.
Always drinking. Isn't that terrible? Oh.
That's their noise.
Trying to get the children. Lovely up here.
Look at the garden, look at all the vegetables, look how good they look, look. Oh my God.
Isn't it lovely up here? Oh. So peaceful,
yeah.
So
it's
nice.
Still.
Look, there's not a bloody leaf moving. I mean, it couldn't have been a super day.
Oh, we're so lucky out here. This is another house with a vegetable garden in the back.
So they really don't get to know them.
Yes.
Pretty garden at the bottom of the wall. This is the 14th century gate that we're going to exit by now. This is one of the gates they used to lower at the entrances to keep people out. In super condition. This is the tallest of all the gates around the wall. This is an ice house used to store natural ice from the winter through to the summer for domestic use. So we're not so modern.
No, we turn around and go back. No,
we don't.
Pretty nice. I was getting a bit nervous along here because there's no protection on one side. We're just coming out of the wall again. That's where we've been. This is the Merchant Adventurers Hall. You know what year this is, Avril?
I don't know. Merchant Adventurers Hall. I don't think it's on here.
No.
It's not on here.
This is
1357.
There's some Elizabethan room. 89 foot by 40 foot great hall.
It's divided in two by central pillars. The windows were inserted in the early 18th century to give more light. Looking back to the entrance door, two of the original windows, now blocked, can be seen high on the north end of the garden. At the end of the hall, something in 1722, are the remains of the Elizabethan panelling.
Oh, God.
Yeah. The elevated governor's stall, which is at the end, came to the company from the former size court in York Castle, demolished in 1770. The size judge would have sat in the central niche between the two sheriffs of York. Today the governor still uses the stall at court meetings with the company's maids resting on the desk in front of him. Funds to relieve the suffering of the parliamentary prisoners housed in squalid conditions in the undercover.
These chairs.
I know, I love it. Love it. I like this table and chairs. Oh yes, little thin pen. She wrote, I've got one letter from her, you know that?
Port wine, 10.5 bottles, sherry bottles, 30 sherry bottles, and biscuits. Right, all together, £3. And about £3 was that? 60. How do you call it?
The old pence.
They've got £3.60. £12.60. £12.60. Right? Yeah. It's 2 to 12. That's the shilling, right? £1.60. £3.60. In old money. £3.60 in old money. £2.60 from the waiter. £3, £8.60.
Look at this spooky one. £16.14.
See, this is where that original old panel is in the Great Hall.
All the people.
walked over here and all this shouting going on in here.
Look at the wood people.
I love buildings like this. Wouldn't it be nice for a house in here? No, really.
So where are we going? Can't we go down to the
street? I think so.
Let you go in
here.
The large, don't know, the large chair in the third room is a rare example of the late 16th century wood turner's craft.
This is 17th century walnut chairs. The undergrowth.
Or Trinity Hospital, as it was called up to the 19th century.
Or Trinity Hospital.
Has housed over.
This was used as a hospital in the 1800s. People there?
They're the master governors.
The master governors of this hall.
This is in Merchant of York.
William Bedale, 1432. And way back to Dick Reed, 1993. This is the outside on here. On the other side of the building.
Another one, a smaller one.
Oh, the town crier of York. We are inside the Castle Museum in York now, and I'm photographing this because I have a lot of these at home. This is the National Street of York, and all the original shops are taken and put inside this building. It's all authentic. I think this is fantastic. It's the nicest museum I've ever been in. Everything from the cobble street to the old fire engine. This is a candle making shop. The 1706 stagecoach. Natural York stagecoach. I think so.
Yeah. I wonder if it's worth me taking that in my camera. I don't know if it'll come out, you know.
Oh, it will. It's an old kitchen. There's a whole bunch of kitchens in here from the oldest to the newest.
blanket my grandmother had that we used to wring the clothes out in, only it was my job. It was very difficult.
Not really.
This used to be the lavatory outdoors, the bathtub that I used to bathe in. Victorian room. Some of the stuff my grandmother would have had in her house, but I don't like it. I imagine at one time this was a very important spot. That's the cathedral above the wall there. And the wall goes right around here. Right around. And then there's an art gallery that had to be some sort of government house at one time. And then over there is the royal residence where kings from Henry VIII stayed. You can see the perhaps the royal insignia in there. Very impressive. Hi, Henry. We've come to Castle Howard, the house that was used in Brideshead Revisited. This is one of the gardens. That is it. Look at that. Seems a little bit criminal, you know, for any one person to have so much. Phew. The sounds you might hear in the background sometimes are peacocks. This is one of them. Struck like a peacock. Oh, I do wish he'd put his tail up. Come closer. Yeah. Gorgeous. The remains of the old servants' quarters, the butler's pantry, the old fireplace, the safe in the wall.
That's from 1882 in that pantry.
1882.
Those shelves and tiles and
the floor. Yeah.
One thing.
The house was started in 1700. apparently there was a bad fire here, and that's when they decided not to redo this but put the servants somewhere else in the house. 1940, a fire destroyed two-thirds of this house. This is a picture of it. And this part of the house is the only part that they didn't resurrect. We've just come from Brideshead, which was a bit disappointing because we couldn't photograph inside. We come back to the Minster, which we haven't been in yet, so we're about to go in there. It's all being redone on the front. They discovered that the foundation was beginning to crack, and so they've stopped all the traffic through here. This would be the main part of the church, obviously. It's enormous. That brought the Christian religion to this part of the country. This is the chancery where all the bishops still meet. It's a round room. With the most magnificent windows. One of the bishops from 1687. Fantastic organ.
Binnen hebben we gedacht.
This, of course, was a Catholic cathedral until the Reformation. Now it's Church of England. I don't know if I can capture how high this is on this shot here. God, I'm gonna fall over. These are all down in the crypt, showing all the silver. It belongs to the church. This is part of the wall that holds the cathedral up, and this is an original culvert built by the Romans in 1066. It drains the water from underneath this cathedral. That's all right. We're getting ready to leave York soon. This couldn't be more English. Museum, and these are the royal coaches. Oh yes, what a way to travel is right. It's Queen Victoria's coach. That's her sitting there, supposedly. This would be the royal train of today.
That's what they're used to.
Remember, this is a train. Notice the type of hardware on a train like this. These are also kept so beautifully clean. This is the front of a royal train. An 1860 railroad porter. Look at the size of the wheels on it. See all the inlaid wood in here. Netherlands train. Oh dear. Getting too much. What's so remarkable about this is how real this looks. Especially the hands. This is a traveling mail train. These remind me of all the little engines that could. And probably did. Starting with this one. What an incredible thing the invention of the wheel was.
Away to another tune by Birkett for the fifes and drums, clearly written for his own regiment, Buttons in Two. Mounted bands into the centre of the parade. Janus is the skewbald shire horse, that's the brown and white one, and Belisarius, the 14-year-old blue roan. of them is the director of music, Major Colin Reeves. He will conduct as they play Prio Bojenski, which was the favourite of the late Lord Louis Mountbatten when he was colonel of the lifeguards. He decreed that it should always be played when lifeguards are on ceremonial duties.
Really?
just hear the cries of charge, the trumpet sounding, swords flashing, hooves pounding. Well, if you're a romantic, you can. I'm sure Her Majesty is merely enjoying the spectacle and admiring the horses she so loves.
The horses look like they all came out of the same litter.
It's still flattering, you know. Unless it's
So the four divisions return to their positions in the approach route, while the last mounted bands salute Her Majesty. Two drum horses with those heavy, solid silver drums, Belisarius carrying the kettle drums, presented to the Blues in 1805 by George III, and Janus carrying the lifeguards kettle drums, presented by William IV in 1805.
George III yet?
The mounted band's music tends to have a particularly strong cornet line because the cornet players at least have one hand on the reins. And for the most part, they're able to play just about all the time. The woodwind section will have the reins around their wrist. They're the men on the greys at the back of the mounted bands. And you can imagine trying to play an instrument at the same time as a horse's head is bobbing up and down. It's really quite difficult. A lot of them will also be controlling, particularly the drummers, controlling the horses with their legs, with reins attached to the bit. They'll stop in front of the old Admiralty building, and the director of music will turn as the cue for the field officer to give the final present arms. Proceedings here on Horse Guards almost complete. The field officer prepares the parade for the march back to Buckingham Palace. And this time, Her Majesty will ride at the head of her foot guards. So the mounted bands will move away into the approach road to lead the whole procession back down the mall to Buckingham Palace. Thank you. close up into the column of route. And again, the core of drums provide the music. This time it's Prussian Glory. For a good wash down and feed, perhaps a few sugar lumps and maybe the odd bit of beer and the oats for the horses.
This is the end of it.
Getting to it.
Yeah. I'm going off down, getting ready to go off down.
General's office, Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, and are riding back down the Mall to Buckingham Palace. Meanwhile, the field officer has ridden forward to take his leave from Her Majesty. Major, 6'6" of him, Perry Mason. The approach road, and he will give the signal to the field officer
without that busby,
when
my
all
God.
Is clear in the mouth for the royal procession to head off back to Buckingham Palace. Clayton comes out again. It's been kept all this time under the archway of the old Admiralty building.
If he went to Windsor, it's tomorrow,
sir. No, Monday morning.
If you went, when
there's the signal to the field officer that the Queen Mother's procession is now clear, well down the mall. Once Her Majesty is into the phaeton, will be all clear for them to go. They go to the march, the Bond of Friendship. Division which prides itself on its family links, but its spirit of camaraderie and support, and the way it looks after its own. We'll follow Her Majesty back to Buckingham Palace, where once more they'll march past before most return to barracks, although for some men of the escort and number 2 guard, it's straight on to sentry duty at the palace and at St James's Palace for another 24 hours as Queen's Guard.
Thank you.
Battalion, Coldstream Guards march on parade and into history. That colour represents heroic deeds and valiant causes won and lost over 300 years of proud and distinguished service. The birthday parade is a glorious and happy celebration of the Queen's long reign. But for these men at least, it must be tinged with a little sadness.
Pretty sad, I would think.
Some will join the 1st Battalion, some will stay in London as members of the newly formed Public Duties Company. Others will return to City Street. All of them can go in the knowledge of a difficult job superbly executed, as the battalion's final act of major ceremonial, before, in the curious language of the military, it goes into suspended animation.
Scots Guards, no Irish Guards, no Grenadier Guards in this. It was just a cold stream.
Right, yeah. It's true.
And there's a second, this is the second regiment. The first regiment stays, I guess. Some of these, they said, will be taken in the first regiment. Others will just become civilians again. Thinking what she'll have for lunch. And then, my God, I'll be glad to get out of this corset.
The household division has a unique way of celebrating the sovereign's birthday. Many things have changed since the young Princess Elizabeth first renewed this parade 42 years ago. What hasn't is the guardsmen's skill and expertise and their unswerving loyalty and dedication to the service of the crown. Attributes Her Majesty has shown in equal measure. Perhaps in difficult times, these are qualities and cornerstones that we should strive to hang on to. The rest of the world admires them. Maybe we shouldn't blow out the candles just yet.
Well, what an exciting thing.
Isn't that one of you standing on the side of the road? You do see an awful lot on television. I know you say you don't get the atmosphere, but look at all the detail and everything, it's amazing.
Look at that face there.
Oh, isn't that brilliant? Oh.
An edited recording of this morning's parade, together with the RAF flypast and the appearance of the royal family on the balcony of Buckingham Palace, can be seen this evening at 7:05 on BBC Two. And in a couple of minutes here on BBC One, an afternoon of sporting grandstand, including the first of the men's semi-finals in the tennis championship.
Well, I'll never forget that I saw this at Shirley and Charles' house.
Oh. 1993. This is our last morning at Shirley's house. And this is a view from our bedroom window. We're way up high on a hill. And this is the moors where Shirley walks her dog every day. Quite pleasant to be able to look out here, especially on a sunny day.
My sister's house now in Chobham, Surrey, and she's out backyard cutting the grass. It was a lovely sunny day. It's nice to be here and to be able to relax because we've been running around the whole country and I'm exhausted. She has a pretty garden, but it's huge. It's a lot of work. This is in the kitchen, looking out the back garden. She works like 48 hours a day at the office, and so she doesn't really get very much time out here anymore. It's a big place to keep going. favourite corner, the garden. Yeah, how would you like to mow that lot? To the left is an orchard through there, lots of trees. Across the street is this lane which is really for riding horses. But it's so pretty today with the sun shining through. And then to the left is the horse farm. Through there. That's very country. Very pleasant. The world seems so peaceful here. This is the road on which she lives. It's called Mincing Lane. And of course that's a house. And then the other way round, you can see it's very country, very nice. Well, back to Priscilla, still at it, but she's finally finished. The grass looks like a golf course. This is the back end where the fruit trees are, and it goes all the way back. Priscilla's cutting a path for me so I can walk down it. All of this back here is quite wild. Well, this is where her land ends, down by the horse farm again. A lot to take care of. Back as far as the tall trees.
Lot of yesterday. Big bow on the front of the hat and the longer length skirt. Very crisp, very nice, perfectly suited to a wonderful summer's day. One of the things everybody's learned here is you need to wear a fabric that doesn't get marked by the rain or has dots in it perhaps before you start. Oh, and look, somebody's got the ideal umbrella to bring a little sunshine into the day. And she's obviously wearing a Versace style jacket, and of course her partner quite rightly has got the wellies I've been looking for all morning. Oh look, little hats on top of big hats. Far less of this today, the sort of novelty outfit, but that one is quite subtle by comparison to some we've seen in the past. This lady's wearing a charm bracelet umbrella and a very nice sombrero under that, and she's got short sleeves and again the sort of sludgy natural colours which we've seen with a gold bag. We're going to wear a pudding basin hat. This is the sort of big straw to wear it in. And lots of black as we've seen yesterday and today, and quite a subtle colour to wear. A lot of jewellery, this Ascot. Lots of sort of chokers, pearls, pearl earrings. Lots of accessorising very carefully, either with the real thing or the cheaper version. And also quite a lot of bare flesh, quite a lot of very short skirts today, quite a lot of low décolletage at the front, so chests seem to be in. It's a lady on the left with a Chanel style short tweed jacket, and you can see women are walking this way not because they've had a drink or two, but because their shoes are getting stuck in the mud. They talk about soft going for horses, the same problem for women. Ah, look. She's got a sort of furry, feathery hat, which might well be keeping her warm. And then the chopper. We've seen more of these today than yesterday, but they certainly are the fashionable shape this season. Black and white, very simply done. She does look as if she can stride out. And that's a cloquet silk outfit probably is quite warm and quite thick. wonderfully large, big, typically Ascot hats. How unsuitable it is with this rain coming down. It looks a bit more like Ascot Sur Mer, but there's some way of keeping your ears warm and dry with that sort of flying saucer on top. She does look as if she's quite comfortable. It's another sort of flying saucer style hat, all in cream and white, and she's wearing trousers underneath that, so I think it must be a bit schizophrenic with a big hat at the top and flare trousers at the bottom. A little flower, a little petal here, all in bright yellow. The antennae at the top look as if they could receive a TV station, and here's more of the tulle we saw yesterday. Tulle-edged hat in black and white. And my favourite shape of the season, you can't even be sure who's underneath there, but you can be sure she looks as if she's wearing a thermal vest underneath it all. You can just see a touch of white.
He followed. Well, only one man's trained two winners so far, this Royal Ascot, and it completes a record, because every year since 1974, he's trained at least one winner at the Royal Meeting. He is, of course, Henry Cecil. Henry, when you came today, you must have been a little bit concerned with this rain for Ardkin Class.
A little bit, because when I ran him in the first classic trial, he sort of tailed off, and they sort of ground him. But he hadn't come to himself, and I was so pleased with him, and there's only one Ascot, isn't there? So we thought we'd take a chance.
Well, he won well, and Percival won well yesterday.
Yeah, it was nice. I mean, he's a nice horse. He's a very well-bred horse, and nice to see him just for coming to himself. It was good.
It's a fantastic record to have saddled a winner every year since 74. Obviously, the week's very special to you.
Well, I think one's expected to do something like...
So, Girl Splash just going in. The area's nicer. Not sure how many have gone in, but it looks as if she could be the last one. Let's join Peter O'Sullivan.
That's it. And they're running in the coronation. Girl Splash breaks fast on the far side, but on the near side, Slow Nice are just a little bit slowly away. Zorani Sidiana, the leader. Zorani Sidiana from Girl Splash, and then comes Samoto. And Elizabeth Bay with Nicer the back marker of the quintet, and Zorani Sidiana making it from Girl Splash, Sumoto, Elizabeth Bay, and Nicer. Zorani Sidiana and Walter Swinburne from Girl Splash, and Gerald Mosse with Sumoto just in behind them. Just towards the outside then is Elizabeth Bay and Nicer, still the back marker, as they race towards the five pole. Zorani Sidiana from Girl Splash in second, then Sumoto, Elizabeth Bay on the outside, Nicer in fifth. Racing now towards the home turn in the Coronation Stakes, and still Zorani Sidiana from Girl Splash in second, then Sumoto, and Zorani Sidiana still holding Girl Splash as they turn into the straight. Elizabeth Bay improving now on the outside of Sumoto. Nicer still just the back marker of the quintet. Zorani Sidiana by about a length and a half from Girl Splash, then Elizabeth Bay, then Sumoto, and finally Nicer. Zorani Sidiana going for home now under Walter Swinburne. Girl Splash trying to get on terms. They're racing towards the furlong pole. Zorani Sidiana from Girl Splash. These two being chased all the time by Elizabeth Bay. Zorani Sidiana from Girl Splash. Girl Splash racing around all the time. So is Elizabeth Bay on the outside. And Girl Splash now takes it up from Elizabeth Bay. It's Girl Splash from Elizabeth Bay as they race up towards the line. Girl Splash being chased by Elizabeth Bay, but Girl Splash and Elizabeth Bay in a photo. Girl Splash is running from Elizabeth Bay. Zorani Sidiana is third, and four is Nicer, and five is Sumoto. Girl Splash has won it for me, although the judge has called for a photo once again. I think we'll find that the Head family have maintained their tradition in the Coronation Stakes, in which Alec Head trained the winner in 1956 with Midget, written by Ray Johnson in 1950.
Showed off that yellow and white straw hat that she was wearing. Underneath she was wearing a very bright yellow suit, but we didn't really get a glimpse of that. Princess Michael of Kent didn't wear her mac when she came down, and she was wearing one of the fashionable pull-down cloches we've seen everywhere, and a fairly long pleated skirt in ice blue. Michael Howard managed to escape the duties of the House of Commons, and here with his ex-model wife, Sandra, looked terrific. Petronella Wyatt wore a big red straw hat, check jackets, which were very popular, in fact a check suit with a rather nice long skirt. Sensible shoes were very sensible for today, although a lot of stilettos were around. This lady very smartly bought a rug, obviously to keep her warm later. The big pull-down hat was everywhere. This was very subtly matched up to very, very pale green. That's with a nice, very long skirt to match. Lady Lee in the Chanel, well, the Chanel-type look, certainly in white and black, followed a lot of women's strong ideas when she wore a slightly warmer suit.
Mm,
and white was everywhere. This almost morning pale jacket looked rather nice. And although we knew it was going to be cold, there was a lot of chest area you could see today. But I'm afraid goosebumps did cover us all. Chanel, without doubt, has been the most dominating look of this ascot. And here, yellow and black proved that it was very successful. Now, what do you do if you want to wear a Mac and show off your dress at the same time? This is a sort of open-top Mac, and very successful it was today. Very pretty way of keeping warm at the same time as looking good. There were stilettos everywhere, platform shoes too. Platform shoes kept your feet out of the rain, stilettos got stuck in the mud. And here, a whole view of muted greens, from the pull-down hat to the jacket, and then to this pistachio and white suit. And a deeper green, and this has got big spots. The topper, as a hat for ladies as well as for men, was around everywhere. Perhaps her husband should have been encouraged to wear a ponytail to match too. Cloquet silk was rather warm, and this very simple outfit in black and white showed that you could look attractive as well as staying warm, and this is something you can keep your ears warm with, a turban with a flying top on top. Lots of bows on bags, dresses, and particularly hats.
Bows, is
salmon pink was one colour that caught the eye, and here's another topper in bright red. A Ralph Lauren coat underneath it, or a coat dress, was very apt. Now it shows that women will suffer to be beautiful when you see this girl in a short-sleeved white dress. But the professionals, Natalie and Henry Cecil here, stayed warm with mats that they probably never go without. I thought at first this girl was looking for a pound she might have lost earlier, but then I realised she was very carefully pushing her way through the mud. And these two, very, very smart, epitomised the look, I think, of Ascot, that short skirts have remained. And now, the most useful accessory you might need, let's hope they don't have to come out tomorrow and just stay there in the grass. The day began with the Jersey Stakes, a race that Henry Cecil has dominated for the past 8 years. But the favourite in this was the Richard Hannon-trained Revelation.
And Art King Glass. Art King Glass has made very good progress on the far side, on the near side, Humam, and then Revelation in the centre, Eurolink Thunder. They're making heavy work of it, these horses, though. They're getting very tired indeed. Art King Glass just has the advantage on the far side, and it's the far side of the moment. Abby's Gals right up with them too, and Matalo coming there as well, but Art King Glass has the advantage from Matalo as they race into the closing stages. Matalo coming to challenge Art King Glass. Art King Glass and Matalo. Art King Glass is money from Matalo.
And glamorous, because they were wearing the shapes they liked, the skirt legs they liked, and the colours they liked, and everything looked right. Even the men looked quite good. It was sad not to see the Queen Mother, but the crowd got a really good look at the royal party when they went to visit the enclosure. The Queen, in her pale peach outfit, had organza draped round her dress and organza draped round her hat. And you can see that very, very subtle kick feet at the back.